As in most wars, civilians are shouldering the brunt of the war in Syria. With the latest from the conflict, here's Tom Porteous. He's Deputy Program Director with Human Rights Watch. And we're glad to have you on this side of the pond and in our studio today, Tom.
Thanks, I'm glad to be here.
Well, your group has been looking into numerous accusations of atrocities in Syria since the regime started to crack down, I guess, about a year and a half ago. What have you found?
Well, we've found a whole range of things. I mean, where to start, really? Civilians are really bearing the brunt of the fighting.
Death toll
in
at the moment?
The death toll is, according to the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, which seems to be keeping the most accurate tally, is 32,000 and counting. Most of those civilians, let's say in the region of 26,000, but we have to be very careful. I mean, these are just guesstimates, really.
And how do they die?
Well, there's a range of different reasons for death. I mean, first of all, one of the most recent developments has been the increasing use by the Syrian government of aerial attacks on rebel forces. But they appear to be, from our documentation, they are, in fact, indiscriminate attacks in which large numbers of civilians are being killed.
Are these so-called cluster bomb drops? Is that the kind
Well,
of
there's cluster bombs, which cluster bombs are anyway illegal under international law. There's a treaty banning them, which Human Rights Watch actually helped to put in place. But it's not just cluster bombs. I mean, it's the use of ordinary bombs in residential areas. One of the very disturbing things that we documented in August was the attacks on bread lines. People queuing up for bread. There are shortages of food at the moment, so they're queuing up for bread. And these bread lines, we documented 10 different instances over quite a short period of attacks, mostly from the air, on bread lines, which suggests very much that these were deliberate targetings of civilians, which of course is a war crime. And one of the people we spoke to who was a witness to one of these attacks was a chap called Samir, who hid during the attack. He ran out onto the street to see what had happened, and he found tens of people lying dead in the street, limbs all over the place, and one little boy was dead. His head was cracked open. He still had a little bit of bread in his mouth from when he was the moment he was killed.
And these attacks would have come from the sky or the ground?
These attacks mostly from the sky, but some from the ground as well. So there's also been shelling. But then another cause of death is that people are being subjected to extrajudicial executions, sometimes obviously in detention, which is very, very disturbing. We've actually, unfortunately, witnessed this, documented this, not just on the side of the government, but also on the side of armed opposition forces.
Well, let me follow up on that, because this is not one of those simple conflicts where one side's got the black hats on and the other side's got the white hats on. The folks who've got the white hats on, I've read and am told, are doing some pretty bad stuff as well. Is that right?
Well, I mean, let's put this in the historical perspective. Okay. I mean, the uprising started inspired, obviously, by what was going on in the rest of the region, people rising up against repressive regimes in the name of dignity and in the name of human rights as well. In Syria, it started in the south when a number of kids were released from detention bearing signs of torture. And this sparked an uprising in Syria, which started in the south but spread throughout the country. And for several months at the beginning of this uprising, it was peaceful protesters taking to the streets, and the response of the regime was formidably repressive and abusive, opening fire on peaceful demonstrators, rounding up large numbers of people, systematic use of torture in torture centers throughout the country, which again we've documented. This went on for several months, and inevitably, with this increased repression, the protesters started to arm themselves. There were also a large number of defections from the Syrian army. These are people who were trained, in fighting, and therefore they were able to kind of come in and start protecting protesters. And gradually this peaceful protest morphed into a civil war. And on the side of the opposition, armed opposition forces, yes, there have been examples of quite serious abuses, extrajudicial executions, mistreatment and torture of detainees, and so on.
What position does that put you in? If both sides are torturing and killing, admittedly one side far more than the other, but your job is to watch out for human rights violations everywhere, how do you handle all that?
Well, we do what we do everywhere, which is we document the human rights abuses that are taking place. It's very important that we should be seen as non-partisan, that we're not taking sides in a conflict. Our job, our mandate, is to document in as meticulous and thorough detail as possible the human rights abuses that are taking place, then to expose those to the world through the media, and then to put pressure on whoever is in a position to actually influence the situation to do so and to end or at least to mitigate those abuses. And we do that, you know, whoever is carrying out those abuses.
But this is what I mean. If you're going to, presumably, part of your mandate at some point is going to be putting pressure on governments who are in a position to do something about this to do something about this. But what do you say? Do you, you know, only worry about the human rights abuses of the regime, but kind of forget about the other side?
Or no, absolutely not. In fact, you know, I mean, in Libya, for example, where we were on the ground throughout the Libyan conflict, we were documenting abuses on both sides. And in fact, in some ways, we had more influence. We were able to exert more influence over the opposition forces because we were already in a dialogue with them. And we got them, for example, to issue a statement, you know, kind of calling on their forces not to mistreat detainees and so on. And we're trying to do the same thing in Syria at the moment. And I think that the Syrian opposition is very conscious, or at least parts of it, because it's very fragmented, are very conscious of the need to observe the rules of war, the laws of war, the Geneva Conventions and so forth, because after all, they know that this started as a peaceful uprising in the name of protecting human rights and dignity. And if they then start to abuse human rights, then they lose the moral high ground which they've had up until now. So I think that, you know, we do have some influence over the opposition. I'm afraid with the Syrian government, they've shown that they're pretty much impervious to influence. And that's why we are calling for much greater unity and consensus in the international sphere than there has been up until now. Because as you know, the Security Council has been so divided that they've been unable really to even to issue the mildest of rebukes to the Syrian government in the course of this 18-month civil conflict.
But greater unity at the international level means what, though?
It means getting, frankly, it means getting the Chinese and the Russians to stop blocking resolutions which rebuke the Syrian government and that would put serious pressure on them through sanctions, through particularly calling for the referral of the situation in Syria to the International Criminal Court, which is one way of deterring further abuses. Because our hope, and this is one of the reasons why we document all these abuses on both sides, but I mean the lion's share of the abuses on the side of the government, the reason why we document all this stuff is partly to ensure that in one day, maybe not tomorrow or next month or even next year, but one day those responsible for these heinous crimes will be taken to court and will face some kind of accountability for it.
Let me see if I can better understand your position, though, because much of the world believes that if the Assad regime falls or is replaced or swept aside somehow, things will get better. There would be fewer human rights abuses if that were to take place. So can your organization go on record and say, China, Russia, stop intervening, let the West do what some in the West want to do, which would be attack, invade, you know, impose a no-fly zone, something like that. In other words, do you see a military solution here?
We don't at the moment see a military solution. And, you know, Human Rights Watch has a very high bar for calling for a military solution for any kind of, in any kind of crisis of this kind. At the moment, we see the solution in terms of putting greater pressure on the Syrian regimes through sanctions, through targeted sanctions against those who are responsible for these abuses, and through a referral of the situation to the International Criminal Court, and through a serious arms embargo on the Syrian government. Many of the, obviously, you know, we've documented the indiscriminate use of military power, air power, artillery, and so forth against civilian, you know, against residential areas. These attacks are being carried out with weapons that have been supplied by all sorts of weapon suppliers. Clearly, if there was an airtight embargo, this would gradually reduce the ability of the Syrian government to carry out these kinds of indiscriminate and abusive attacks.
Ann Applebaum wrote the following last month in Slate.com. Don't know if you had a chance to look at it, but I'll read an excerpt here. She writes, "One has to go back to the Battle of Britain or the firebombing of Dresden to find another war in which one side purposefully set out to kill enemy noncombatants, women, children, and the elderly from the air. But even those comparisons aren't really analogous. Unlike the air forces operating during World War II, Bashar al-Assad isn't trying to kill enemy noncombatants. He's trying to kill his own people." Given your own experience there, can you compare the situation in Syria to anything else that you've seen during the course of your time at Human Rights Watch?
I think it's very hard to think of anything comparable.
So it is unique in its evil.
It is unique in the, as Ann Applebaum says, in the extent to which, in recent times anyway, the extent to which civilians are being, in some cases deliberately targeted, in some cases subjected to totally indiscriminate attacks from the air, but also from artillery. I think artillery is still causing more damage, probably, against civilians than air attacks, but that may be changing with as the war develops. Of course, one of the reasons why the government has resorted to air attacks is because, you know, they're fairly desperate. They've lost a lot of territory, mm-hmm. and some of these areas, the only way they can reach them is through air attacks.
So how about a no-fly zone? That's military intervention, but of a very preliminary nature.
I think the problem with probably very little doubt that we've reached the threshold where, all things being equal, no-fly zone would be warranted in order to protect civilians. I think the real problem comes when we start to weigh the consequences. Would it cause more harm than good? And I think the situation in the region at the moment is so complex. It's not just a question of looking at Syria, but looking at the region as a whole, the situation in neighboring countries and so on, that it's very hard to actually say with real certainty that a no-fly zone would cause more good than harm. Who would carry it out? What would be the agenda of those people carrying
Turkey's
out?
Turkey's right on the border. They'd probably step up to the plate right
away.
Well,
the Turkey have said that they wouldn't step up to the plate unless there was a international support for it. There are a lot of real questions about the long-term consequences. In terms of would it do more harm than good? And I think that those questions really need to be, if a human rights organization like Human Rights Watch is to call for something as dramatic as a military intervention, I think they have to be pretty sure that the consequences are going to be beneficial. And I think in this case, it's very hard to actually make that judgment, but we're keeping it under review. As the situation changes, not only on the ground, but in the international diplomatic sphere, we are keeping this option under review.
No, and don't misunderstand, I'm not trying to beat the drum for war here, and we've seen in Iraq and Afghanistan how things which are often promoted as, oh, this will be easy peasy lemon squeezy, turns into something quite different. Having said that, what's going to stop tens of thousands of Syrians from being killed by their own government?
Unfortunately, it's already happening. And not only that, but we're seeing, the continuation of this massive campaign of torture against Syrians. We've documented tens of thousands of people going through this system of arbitrary detention, being arrested. Lots of ordinary civilians, journalists, lawyers, ordinary
people. Okay, so how do we stop it?
It's really very difficult to come up with a clear answer to that. I mean, our recommendation is that we need to continue to have to push the Chinese and the Russians at the Security Council to stop blocking determined Security Council action in the form of a clear condemnation, sanctions, referral of the whole situation to the International Criminal Court, already the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights at the UN and the UN Human Rights Council Commission of Inquiry has determined that these are crimes against humanity that have been committed. That needs to be followed up with resolute judicial action.
I think, Tom, you know this more about this than I do. That's years in the making. Mm. What's going to stop the killing now?
It's not going to stop now. It's going to continue.
But surely,
it's going to continue for some time to come.
Surely that should be our goal here, should it not?
It is our goal, but you know there are some situations that are really intractable, and it's very hard to. It's very hard for us to, if there was a solution that we could put our finger on and say, this is the solution, it's going to end the problem, it's going to end all these human rights abuses, and it's not going to have some drastic consequences in 2 or 3 months down the road, then yes, we'd go for it. But I mean, I don't think there is a very clear and obvious solution to this problem. And I say that with a very heavy heart, because we have been working very hard to document and expose the abuses that are taking place. It's very sad to say no, there is no silver bullet which is going to solve this problem in the near future. And there's going to be more killing. There's going to be more torture. There's going to be more arbitrary detentions. I think we have to steel ourselves for that. But we also need to keep all the options on the table for when we can determine that there is a solution, and we should go for it. And at that point, I think we should we need to be ready to act when we can make a firm determination that action the action that is being proposed is not going to cause more harm than good.
Right, understood. Tom Porteous from the Human Rights Watch. You're based in Washington, D.C., but obviously you're from over there in the U.K., and we're glad you spared some time for us at TVO tonight.
I'm very pleased to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.